There is something you, next, is, Sergey, Ray,
thank you for the introduction. As you can see, there are eight. Go.
Go. It's not responding. On the switcher.
Thanks. First of all, I would like to say that the cause of why I'm here is that I'm a man of a good family. This family includes, but is not limited to Rosemary Bailey, Larry Cameron, Chris Evans, Alexander Gavrilik, Vyacheslav Kabanov, Andrey Panasin, Ganesh Shalakhin, and Alexander Vujicic. I'm going to talk about three results that are somehow connected and have a perception that the notion of cliques in strong irregular graphs. The first result is on maximum cliques in plane graphs of square order. The second result is on equitable partitions for plane square graphs. And the third result is on numeric graphs. Yesterday, Bruce Evans gave a talk on this topic, so I'm going to discuss this third result briefly, and I'm going to focus on the first two results. Okay, let's have a look at the outline of the first part of my talk. I will start with some preliminary results, then I will discuss two families of maximum cliques in Bailey graph of square order, and then I will discuss some connections of this maximum cliques with eigenfunctions of Bailey graphs that have minimum cardinality of support. Okay, let's see one, the odd prime power, which is congruent Q1 is equal to 1 modulo 4. The Bailey graph of order Q1, denoted by P of Q1, is a graph defined as follows. The vertex set is a finite field FQ1, and two vertices, gamma 1 and gamma 2, are adjacent, if and only if their difference is a square in the multiplicative group. Since minus 1 is a square in this multiplicative group, if and only if Q1 is congruent to 1 modulo 4, the graph P of Q1 is an indirect a clique or a clique in an indirect graph is a set of pairwise adjacent or non-adjacent speculative vertices. And let us formulate the first problem. What are maximum and what are maximal but not maximum cliques or cliques in Bailey graphs? Since P of Q1 is self-complementary, the studying cliques and the studying of cliques in this graph are equivalent. And since P of Q1 is strongly regular, we can apply the Lissard-Hoffmann bound to P of Q1. And this bound says that a clique or a clique in this graph has at most square root of Q1 vertices. The first problem is unsolved in general, but in 2016, Greaves and Socher improved the Lissard-Hoffmann bound for infinitely many visible parameter tuples for strong regular graphs, including infinitely many parameter tuples that correspond to Bailey graphs, and here is the link. Now suppose that Q1 is a square According to the result of the bound, the clique in P of Q squared has at most Q vertices. Since every element from FQ star is a square in FQ square star, this field FQ induces a clique of size Q in the query graph of order Q square, which implies that the result of the bound is tight. In 1984, Block Twist classified maximum cliques in query graphs of square order and proved that such a clique is an affine image of the subfield FQ. Denotes given an odd prime power Q denoted by R of Q, 1 if Q is congruent to 1 modulo 4, and 3 if Q is congruent to 3 modulo 4. In 1996, Baker and others found a maximum cliques of size Q plus R of Q over 2 in perigraphs of in the perigraph for the Q square for any odd prime power Q. In 2018, so this year, together with my co-authors, we found one more infinite family of maximum cliques, one more family of maximum cliques in the perigraph of order Q square with the same size. And this slide contains some computational results. So it has a table with three rows. The first row means Q. The second row means the clique size that corresponds to size Q plus R of Q over 2. And in the second row, the number of orbits on cliques or on maximum cliques of such size is given. And we can see that if Q is greater or equal to 25, we have precisely two non-equivalent cliques for all Q up to 83. So it seems that we can from this conjecture, and this conjecture is as follows. The graph P of Q squared contains exactly two non-equivalent cliques of this size. Okay, plus some general some general information, but now let us have a look more precisely. Fixing on square D in FQ star and consider the polynomial F of T, which is irreducible over FQ, then it's well known that the field FQ squared can be represented as a set of all sums x squared plus y alpha, where x and y runs over FQ, where alpha is the root of the polynomial F of T. Let beta be a primitive element of the field FQ square, and note that the elements of the multiplicative subgroup of the smallest field FQ star are squared since they are generated by the element beta in Q plus 1. Okay, the crucial point of the investigation of cliques in perigraph square order is the correspondence between the elements of this finite field and the points of the corresponding affine geometry. Let V of 2Q be a two-dimensional vector space over Q. Consider the affine plane A of Q, whose points are vectors of V of the vector space V. Lines are all chemical cells of one-dimensional subspaces, and the incidence relation is natural, which means that the point is incident to the line, if and only if the corresponding vector belongs to the corresponding coset. Since FQ square can be viewed as a two-dimensional vector space over FQ, points of on this affine plane can be matched with the elements of the affine field as follows. Okay, let us introduce the notion of quadratic and non-quadratic lines in this in this affine plane. Given a line L in this plane, there exist elements x1 plus y1 alpha and x2 plus y2 alpha, such that this line L can be represented as on the slide. So C runs over Q, and these two elements are fixed. So each line has Q points. The line L is called be quadratic or non-quadratic if x2 plus y2 alpha is a square or non-square respectively in the multiplicative group of the finite field of order Q square. It's easy to see that the subfield of Q is an example of a quadratic line, and there are precisely Q plus 1 lines through the point. Among them, Q plus 1 over 2 quadratic lines and Q plus 1 over 2 non quadratic lines. Okay. Let us point out the correspondence between points. Let us view the polygraph square order as a graph on points of the affine plane for any distinct elements gamma 1, gamma 2. The difference is gamma 1 minus gamma 2 is the square in this field, which is equivalent to the adjacency of these vertices in the graph, if and only if the line connecting these points is quadratic. Okay, let us discuss what is the geometric structure of maximum cleats found by Baker and others. Take an element gamma such that gamma belongs to FQ squared but doesn't belong to FQ. Since FQ is a quadratic line, the line through gamma that is parallel to FQ is quadratic too. So Q. Let us take the line through gamma, which is parallel to Q, and we have Q minus 1 over 2 quadratic lines through gamma, and all of them intersect the line of Q. So let us Let's collect the intersection points. Have q minus 1 over 2 intersection points. And since these lines are quadratic, gamma is adjacent to these vertices in the Petri graph. Okay, and so if we consider gamma as x plus y alpha, let us consider its conjugate, which is x minus y alpha, and it can be shown that this conjugate element gamma bar is adjacent to the same vertices from the line of Q. And if Q is compared to 1, modulo 4, each of the sets gamma joined with x gamma, which is the set of all intersection points, and gamma bar with the same set induce a maximum clique of size q plus 1 over 2. This means that the line, so if q is congruent to 1 modulo 4, this means that the line connecting gamma and gamma gamma bar is non-quadratic. But if we consider the case when q is congruent to 3 modulo 4, this line becomes quadratic 2, and this clique gamma joined with x gamma can be extended with gamma bar, which gives us a clique of size q plus 3 over 2. So what is the how can we characterize the geometric structure of this maximum clique? This is a set of almost all vertices of this clique lie on a line, and we have one or two exceptional vertices that don't lie on this line. Okay, what's the geometric structure of the maximum cliques given by Becker and others? And let us discuss in a similar way the geometric structure of cliques from the second family. You know by omega beta in q minus 1, let q be a subgroup of order q plus 1 in the multiplicative group of the finite field of order q squared. And q can be naturally divided into two parts with the same cardinality q0 and q1. So q0 is the set of all even powers omega, and q1 is the set of all odd powers omega. And this subgroup Q plays a key role in the construction of the second family. So the main reason is that Q is viewed from different points. And one of these points is that Q is the kernel of the norm mapping. It should be FQ, yeah. Q forms an oval in defined plane, which means that Q is a set of Q plus 1 points with node 3 on the line. Note that Q is generated by element omega, which is an even power of beta. So each element of Q is a square in the multiplicative group. So each element of Q is adjacent to zero, which means that Q is included in the neighborhood of zero. And you have proved that, okay, we investigated what is the adjacency structure, what is the subgraph induced by Q, and you have proved that if Q is congruent to 1 more than 4, then Q induces a complete bipartite graph with paths Q0 and Q1, the paired graph for the square. And if U is congruent to 3 more than 4, then Q induces a pair of disjoint leaves Q0 and Q1. Okay, and now let us discuss more precisely what is the geometric structure of maximum leaves. Given by the second term, if Q is congruent to 1 modulo 4, each of the sets Q0 and Q1 induces a maximal Hopf clique of size Q plus 1 over 2 in the Bailey graph for the Q square. And if we switch to the complement, which is isomorphic to the original graph, we obtain a maximal clique of size Q plus 1 over 2. And if Q is congruent to 3 modulo 4, each of the sets 0 joined with Q0 and 0 joined with Q1 uses the maximum V of size Q plus 3 over 2 in the graph square order. So let us compare this geometric structure with the clique from the construction by Baker and others. So this the second construction is based on oval. So we have a set of vertices such that since they belong to an oval, no three of them are on the line. And possibly we could have, in the case when Q is congruent to 3 modulo 4, we could have one more exceptional vertex, which is adjacent to all this oval. So, in my point of view, this, these two constructions are dual in some sense. So this, in this case, we have that almost all vertices lie on a line. And in this case, almost every triple is not on a line. So, and let us formulate several questions. Is there any duality between the cliques from these two families? Probably, these cliques are equivalent under the action of the automorphism group of the graph, which is actually geometric, but are there any transformations that can map one clique to other? And the second question, is it true that the cliques from these two families are the only maximum cliques of size Q plus R of Q over 2 in big graphs square order. And is it true that there are no maximum limits for size belongs to the gap between these two known sizes? Okay, let us discuss the meaning of this of the second family for the problem of studying eigenfunctions with minimum cardinality of support. Let G be a regular graph, a real valued function f on the vertex set V is called an eigenfunction of the graph of G corresponding to an eigenvalued theta if f has at least one zero value, and for any vertex gamma, the following local condition holds. So some speakers discussed this condition yesterday. Let G be a regular graph. The function f is an eigenfunction of the graph G, corresponding to a principal eigenvalued theta, if f is an eigenfunction of the complementary graph G bar, corresponding to the eigenvalue negative 1 plus theta. So this gives a correspondence between eigenfunctions of the original graph and its complement. Note that this definition of eigenfunctions is equivalent to the usual definition of eigenvector. The only difference is that in the case of the definition of eigenfunction, we just keep the quadrant of vertices. Graph G is called strongly regular with parameters nk, lambda, mu. If G has n vertices, is regular valence k, and any vertices, gamma and delta, have lambda common neighbors if they are adjacent, and mu common neighbors if they are not adjacent. It's well known that in trivial strong regular graph, the parameters nk, lambda, mu has exactly three eigenvalues: the principal eigenvalue k, which is the valency, and the two non principal eigenvalues, theta 1 and theta 2, which can be expressed in nk, lambda, mu. And the following chain of inequalities holds. So theta 2 is the negative eigenvalue, the negative non principal eigenvalue, theta 1 is the positive non principal eigenvalue. Baby graph P of Q1 is a strong regular graph with the following parameters, and its non principal eigenvalues, theta 1 and then theta 2, can be expressed as follows. For a function f, the set of all non zeros is called the support of f. And let us formulate two problems. The first one is to find the minimum cardinality of the support of eigenfunctions of vertex graphs corresponding to non-principal eigenvalues. And problem three, for vertex graphs to characterize eigenfunctions with the minimum cardinality of support corresponding to non-principal eigenvalues. Okay, and let us use the partition of Q into Q0 and Q1 to define a function on the vertices of the Bailey graph of square order. We define a function fq, and if Q of gamma is equal to 1, if gamma belongs to Q0, is equal to minus 1 if gamma belongs to Q1 and 0 otherwise. Since the cardinality of Q is Q plus 1, the support of Q is equal to Q plus 1. And if you prove that if u is congruent to 1 modulo 4, then f u is an eigenfunction of the Peyton graph of square order of order u square corresponding to the eigenvalue theta 2. And if we switch to the complement, this the second function corresponds to the eigenvalue theta 1 of the isomorphic graph. And if u is congruent to 3 modulo 4, we have a similar result. Okay, and there is a so-called weight distribution bound on the number of non-zeros of an eigenfunction of a distance regular graph. And in the case of Peyton graphs of square order, it says that an eigenfunction corresponding to a non-principal eigenvalue has at least q plus 1 non-zeros. Thus, the defined eigenfunction fq meets the weight distribution bound. So let us formulate a question. Is it true that every eigenfunction of Peyton graph of order q squared corresponding to a non-principal eigenvalue and having cardinality of support q plus 1 is equivalent to the eigenfunction fq? It seems that this question is related to the problem of classifying cliques. Yeah, because there is a connection between them. So, any progress in this question can help the other to answer the other question. Okay, now let us discuss the second result. I will start with some preliminary definitions and results. Then we'll discuss equitable partitions of Peyton square graphs. And then we will formulate several questions. An equitable T partition of a K regular graph gamma is a partition of the Velux set V into T parts. V1 so on Vt such that for all I and j from the set 1 so on t, every vertex of Vi is adjacent to the same number, namely Pij of vertices of the set Vj. And the matrix that consists of the numbers Pij is called the quotient matrix of the equitable T partition. So known that every eigenvalue of P is an eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix gamma. In particular, P always has the principal eigenvalue K. Let theta be a non-principal eigenvalue of gamma. We say that the partition P is Q equitable if all non-principal eigenvalues of P are equal to theta. And any equitable two partition is theta equitable for some theta. We call a non-empty proper set S of the vertex of V to be a theta perfect set if the partition into S and its complement is theta equitable. A partition V1 so long VR is theta perfect if each set VI is theta perfect. It can be easily shown, and the following lemma can be found in this link. Let S be a theta perfect set and T be a non empty proper set in proper subset in in B minus S, then T is theta perfect if and only if the union of S and T is theta perfect. Thus, in order to find all theta equivalent partitions, it's sufficient to find all the minimum theta perfect sets. Minimum means that you cannot decompose such a perfect set into two perfect sets with the same eigenvalue of theta. Okay, let me recall the notion of Leydig square and Leydig square graphs. A Leydig square of order n is an n times n array with entries from an alphabet of n vectors such that each letter occurs once in each row and once in each column. Given a Leydig square L, we define the corresponding Leydig square graph gamma of L, whose vertices are the n square cells of the area L, and two vertices are adjacent if and only if they lie in the same row or in the same column or contain the same letter. The graph L, it's well known that the graph L of n is strongly regular with the principal eigenvalue k, which is 3 multiplied by n minus 1, and two non principal eigenvalues, n minus 3 and minus 3. Now let us discuss several straightforward constructions of perfect sets. The first one is given by a clique. Let S be a row or a column or a letter, then S is a n minus 3 perfect set in the Leydig square. So it's easy to see that a row, a column, or a letter is a clique. Yeah, a bit trickier example is given by a corner. So you can see an example. This is the Kelly table of the cyclic group of order 5, and if we consider the left upper corner under the secondary diagonal, so this is the secondary diagonal, and we consider this corner, it's easy to see that this corner set is a n minus 3 perfect set tune in general. Okay, so this gives us the second example of n minus 3 perfect set, which is our goal. Okay, and in order to present the main result, we need to introduce the notion of inflation of Leydig squares. Take Leydig square L0 of order S and replace each appearance of letter I by Leydig square of order T in alphabet AI, which depends on I, where the alphabets for different letters are pairwise adjoined. This gives a Leydig square L of order ST, which is denoted by N. And it's easy to show that this operation of inflation preserves the property to be a perfect set. So if S0 is a S minus 3 perfect set in the small Leydig square, then the corresponding cells in the large Leydig square form and M minus 3 because it said. And the following theorem exhausts the minimal N minus 3 perfect sets in Wedge square graphs. Let S be a minimal N minus 3 perfect set in the graph of Wedge square of order N. Then S is a row of a column or a letter or an inflation of a corner set. And let us consider an example. So this letter square comes from the smallest one, and we match an alphabet which with each letter of the small letter square. So we match alphabet 3 and 4 with the letter 0, 5 and 6 with the letter 1, and 7 and 8 with letter 2. And let us take arbitrary letter squares. So in this case, we have just two letter squares, but in general, they can be arbitrary. And let us replace each entry by a letter square in the corresponding alphabet. So, for example, we replace zeros with different letter squares in the corresponding alphabet, and we do so for all letters in the small letter square. So this gives us an example of letter square, which is inflation of the smallest one. And since the previous, since we had an N minus 3 perfect set in the small letter square, we know that this property to be an N minus 3 perfect set is preserved by inflation. So this gives us a partition of the large letter square, which is also tweetable. So this is just to explain what is the meaning of this theory. Okay, and let us relate several questions. Studying minus three perfect sets. This is the first question. Such a set S has the property that it meets any row, column, or letter in a constant number S of cells, and its cardinality is S times N. In particular, if S is equal to 1, such a set is called transversal. A classification of minus 3 perfect sets would imply a solution for the long-standing Reissner's conjecture. This question seems to be hard. Some families of distance regular graphs have an empty intersection with the family of letter square graphs. For example, the family of bilinear forms graphs. And since we could classify equitable partitions of letter square graphs, can we extend these ideas, can we extend these approaches to some close families of distance regular graphs? And the third question, can we classify equitable partitions of graphs of mutually orthogonal Lagrange squares? Yeah, which is natural generalization of the family of Lagrange square graphs. Okay, that's all.
Thank you very much. We still have 5 minutes.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, we have questions.
Okay, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. talk, but particularly on the geometry explanation of mathematics. Any questions on that?
How do we define that graph for orthogonal identity squares?
Okay, so the definition is the following. Suppose we have two orthogonal identity squares, like something like that. So let us put them together, and in this case, we also have n squared cells, and in the case of Latin square graphs, two cells are adjacent if they lie in a row, in a column, or have the same letter. In the case when we have at least two Latin squares, the adjacency rule is the following: two cells are adjacent if they lie in a row, or in a column, or have the same letter in some of, in at least one of these orthogonal Latin squares. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Did you consider Bayer de Grasse of a different orthogonal square?
Yeah, actually we've considered only paragraph of square order, because yeah, it seems that these two cases are very different, much different.
What about Stanley-Tipper system? The graph coming from Stanley-Tipper system. Do you have similar situation?
We haven't considered this graph yet, so maybe this family could be one of the next terms. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
I have one question. In the first of your talk, so you were talking about five states. And there, astronomers really bring that the water rise, the water appear. Is there any relation to
is there any
relation to the astronomers bring that graph in that part of the talk?
You mean some relations between fine planes and
yeah, the properties you mentioned in the first part,
yeah,
concerning the five planes,
yeah,
and any strongly regular graphs, so there are any limitations or just.
Yeah, actually, there is an interesting family of some regular graphs that comes exactly from this affine plane. So this affine plane has p plus 1 parallel classes, and we can define a graph as follows. Let us consider a subset of these parallel classes, and two points are adjacent if they lie on a line which belongs to the fixed parallel class, to a fixed parallel class. Any such graph is strongly regular. Yeah, also this graph. These graphs can be viewed as graphs given by mutually orthogonal Latin squares. Yeah, so
I understand. Thank you very much. Okay. Any other comments or questions? Okay, if not, let's see. We will have a moment in the next talk with the 12th.